The subcommittee will come to order. After recognizing myself and Ranking Member Ted Deutsch for 5 minutes each for our opening statements, I will be glad to recognize other members seeking recognition for 1 minute. We will then hear from our witnesses. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for being here today. Without objection, the witnesses' prepared statements will be made a part of the record, and members may have five days, shorten that time, to insert statements and questions for the record, subject to the length limitation in the rules. Before we begin, I'd like to seek unanimous consent to enter the testimony of AEI's Dr. Michael Rubin for the record. Dr. Rubin was originally slated to testify at this hearing before it had to be postponed due to inclement weather earlier this month and is now unable to join us today. And we thank him for his contributions to this hearing, and hearing no objections, his statement will be made a part of the record. The chair now recognizes herself for 5 minutes. This week marks the end of the second extension of the Joint Plan of Action. And though no final deal has been made as the negotiations continue, it is important to take stock of where we stand today versus where we stood on November 24th, 2013, when the JPOA was formally announced. While Iran may have complied with some cosmetic aspects of the JPOA, reducing enrichment stockpiles, turning off some centrifuges, the fact remains that Iran's nuclear infrastructure remains entirely intact. Let's pretend for a moment that Iran hasn't already violated the terms of the JPOA, a notion that is as preposterous as Iran's claim to a right of enrichment. The role of monitoring Iran's nuclear program and verifying its adherence to the agreement falls on the International Atomic Energy Agency, the IAEA, and our intelligence community. Neither option inspires much confidence, considering we've failed to detect Iran's covert activity before, and we failed to detect nuclear activity in Syria and North Korea as well in the past. History has shown us that our intelligence assessments are not always perfect, so we cannot allow Iran to even possess the capability to get a bomb, because we very likely would miss it if Iran makes that mad dash. Just last year, the Defense Department put out its own assessment that we do, in fact, lack the capability to detect covert nuclear sites in Iran and wouldn't be able to detect a move toward breakout. And it was before this subcommittee that General Hayden, former director of the NSA and the CIA, echoed that sentiment, saying that as long as Iran continues to block access to its facilities, we wouldn't be able to detect its development of a bomb. He then stated that if he were advising the president, unless Iran came clean about its past weaponization and PMD activities, he would be compelled to say that the deal could not be adequately verified. So then that leaves the lion's share to the IAEA. The IAEA has a long history in Iran, but not nearly as long as Iran's history of subterfuge and covert work on a nuclear weapons program. As a signatory to the NPT and the safeguard agreement with the IAEA since 1974, Iran was required to make accurate and complete declarations of all of its nuclear material and nuclear-related activities to the IAEA. We know that Iran was in violation of this for decades, and being in violation had forfeited any claim it had to enriching uranium. Since 2003, we know that Iran has done everything it can to deceive, block, and prevent the IAEA from gaining the access it needs to verify its nuclear program. Iran has taken advantage of several rounds of negotiations to stall for time and has exploited loopholes and ambiguities to make advances in its nuclear program. And this latest attempt by the P5 plus one is no different. Since November 24th, 2013, as part of the JPOA, the IAEA has been working to get unresolved issues regarding Iran's past, its work on nuclear weapons development, and other possible military dimensions, PMD, of Tehran's nuclear program. Yet even as the negotiations continue, the IAEA reports that Iran has been unwilling to cooperate and is hindering its inquiries. There are still a dozen outstanding questions that the IAEA has about Iran's PMD, possible military dimension, that Iran refuses to provide answers for, giving us more reason to suspect that Iran is pursuing a nuclear program for other than peaceful purposes. The JPOA sets a bar lower than had previously been established through a series of six UN Security Council resolutions. For a nation that has operated a covert nuclear program for decades and which continues to stonewall the most serious inquiries from the IAEA, we should have every reason to suspect that its activities extend further than what has been declared to date. Just a few weeks ago, it was reported that there may indeed be other covert sites that Iran has not previously declared. And that is why this nuclear deal is setting up to be a bad and dangerous deal, because it relies on something we cannot guarantee. The only way that we can ensure that Iran is in compliance with the IAEA obligations and is not paving the way toward a nuclear weapon is to fully dismantle its infrastructure. Because as long as that infrastructure is intact, Iran will always be able to make the decision to go for the bomb, and the IAEA or our intelligence community does not have the ability, despite what President Obama guarantees, to detect it in time. Shame on us. And with that, I'm glad to yield for his opening statement to my good friend from Florida, the ranking member, Mr. Deutsch.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. We are now a week away from the deadline to reach a political framework agreement in the negotiations between Iran and the P5 plus one over Iran's illicit nuclear program. For all the talk about various elements of a potential deal, including future verification and monitoring, it's been easy to lose sight of a very clear, very current indicator of Iran's willingness to comply with international obligations. That is, its repeated stonewalling and noncompliance with the International Atomic Energy Agency. The IAEA first found Iran to be in noncompliance with its obligations as a member of the Nuclear Nonproliferation Treaty in 2005. Between 2005 and 2010, the IAEA issued 30 reports detailing concerns about Iran's activities, ultimately leading to a referral to the Security Council and successive rounds of sanctions, including UN Security Council resolutions demanding that Iran stop enrichment. Running parallel to the current P5 plus one negotiations, the IAEA, arguably the agency that would be charged with carrying out future monitoring and verification of a nuclear deal, has been engaged in a new round of discussions with Iran. On November 11, 2013, the IAEA and Iran signed a joint statement on a framework for cooperation. In the framework for cooperation, the IAEA and Iran agreed to cooperate further with respect to verification activities to resolve all present and past issues. In its latest report on February 19, 2015, the IAEA confirmed that it has only been able to make progress on one out of 12 key issues. The report states, and I quote, that Iran has not provided any explanations that enable the agency to clarify the two outstanding practical measures, nor has it proposed any new practical measures in the next step of the framework for cooperation. As it has for years, Iran has been slow-walking investigations and inspections, refusing to cooperate on providing past activities, and refusing access to various suspect sites. And this is simply to carry out its obligations as a member of the Nuclear Nonproliferation Treaty. There are many of us who fear that this is an unfortunate foreshadowing of the way in which Iran will respond to its obligations should there be a permanent nuclear deal it's reached. If Iran wants to show the world that it can act in good faith, or that we should have any belief at all that this regime could be trusted in the future, it would start by cooperating with the IAEA. If Iran, at the end of any nuclear deal, wants to be treated like any other NPT country, it could start by acting like one now. Extremely concerning throughout this whole process is the refusal to allow IAEA inspectors to certain suspect sites, notably Parchin. With respect to Parchin, as previously reported by the IAEA, the activities that have taken place at this location since February 2012 are likely to have undermined the agency's ability to conduct effective verification. It remains important for Iran to provide answers to the agency's questions and access to the particular location at this site. But most concerning is Iran's refusal to cooperate on the possible military dimensions of its program. How can we construct a viable verification regime going forward if we don't know fully what the Iranians have done in the past with respect to weaponization? Just this week, speaking at a conference, IAEA Director General Amano stated, and I quote, "We are also implementing the Joint Plan of Action, and we can also say the implementation is good. But with respect to the clarification of issues with possible military dimensions, the progress is limited, and this is the area where more cooperation from Iran is needed." Amano said the agency still was not able to conclude whether all nuclear material in Iran was being used for peaceful purposes, saying, "We continue to verify the non-divergence of nuclear material declared by Iran, but we are still not in a position to conclude that all nuclear material in Iran is peaceful in purpose." Given Iran's intransigence, the international community is left with little choice but to believe that it has something to hide. And I, for one, would not be comfortable with any nuclear agreement that doesn't force Iran to come clean on its past activities. As former IAEA official Ali Heinonen wrote earlier this month, the IAEA can only return to routine inspections when the IAEA is certain that all nuclear material and activities are being used exclusively for peaceful purposes. And I, frankly, don't know how we can ever be certain of this when we don't know everything that Iran has done. Furthermore, as I mentioned at the outset, it would be the IAEA who would be charged with carrying out verification and monitoring, should a deal be reached. It's the IAEA that will have to first observe a violation, and then what happens? Do the Iranians stonewall as the international community tries to get additional information? Do they have the opportunity to dispute the IAEA's findings? How long will it take for the IAEA to confirm its findings and report to the P5 plus one? Who's responsible for determining the penalties if a violation occurs? These are all outstanding questions that will need to be answered before any reasonable country should enter into any agreement with Iran. Lastly, let me just say, I frankly am unclear as to how we can reasonably conclude any permanent agreement with Iran on its nuclear activities if the IAEA is unable to finish its parallel investigation. I thank the witnesses for being here today, and I appreciate their insight, and I yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deutsch, for that opening statement. Mr. Issa of California is recognized.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This is an important hearing. I want to hear some of the specifics about the breakout time, the technical problems, and to the greatest extent possible, some of the areas in which the proposed agreement falls short from an inspection standpoint. I also look forward to hearing Mr. Toby, who has vast background and knowledge and history of where we failed before. We failed with India, we failed with Pakistan, we failed with North Korea. The difference in all of those is expansive view of the world and terrorism that clearly is coming from Iran. If they get a nuke, we will never hear or see the last of it in the region. Having said that, I want to echo the statements of both the chairman and ranking member. When they talk about a country that cannot be trusted, Iran comes to the top of the list. Since 1979, consistently, year after year, decade after decade, what Iran says and Iran does are different. And therefore, until or unless there is an inspection regime that is verifiable and has been consistently verified before a deal, any expectation that once sanctions are lifted, that Iran will suddenly be a new and different Iran are in fact sillier than the many turnarounds that we saw in Groundhog Day those many years ago. The fact is, history does repeat itself. Iran will not keep its promises. And Madam Chair, I want to thank you for this important hearing.
Thank you very much, Mr. Issa. Mr. Boyle of Pennsylvania.
Thank you. And I'm reminded of the saying that the best way to predict future behavior is to look at past behavior. So I am especially interested in this subject matter. I've already read the three witnesses' testimonies, and I think that judging Iran's experience with respect to the IAEA is a great way to project future behavior. I also just want to add, following on the last comments that were made by Mr. Issa, it is actually remarkable when you look at humankind over the last 65 years, that nuclear weaponization has been contained to the extent that it has, the challenge of Iran reaching a nuclear capability is, would that be the catalyst to touch off Saudi Arabia and every other regional player also deciding that they would suddenly be interested in this capability? So with only a minute, I'll save the rest of my comments for question time. I'll just say I thank the chair for having, and the ranking member for having this incredibly important hearing.
Thank you, sir. Mr. DeSantis of Florida.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I think a lot of Americans are wondering what's going on with these negotiations. Iran does cheat. Can we trust them? And then, lo and behold, a couple days ago, you have the Supreme Leader, the only decision maker that really matters, chanting, death to America. So is he saying death to America because he means it? If so, why would we be negotiating? If he doesn't mean it, you know, how do we trust what he says? It's interesting how that was dismissed by the White House as, oh, just mere domestic political rhetoric. Don't worry about that. But when the Prime Minister of Israel says something in the heat of the campaign and then explains it, no, you got to hold him to that. You're going to take him to the United Nations now. We're going to turn our back on Israel. The National Intelligence Estimate has removed Iran and Hezbollah as terrorist threats in their recent worldwide threat assessment. Gulf states are responding to the potential for this deal in a way that they clearly don't have confidence in. The socialist president of France is stronger on Iran than the U.S. administration is right now. I look forward to the testimony, but I think I speak for a lot of my constituents that we are concerned about this deal.
Thank you very much, Mr. DeSantis from Florida. Also, Mr. Clausen.
Thank you for coming. Years ago, there was a movie called Animal House, and the characters went on a road trip. You all are probably remember the movie. And the character that needed to supply the vehicle was named Flounder. And it was his brother's, older brother's, shiny black Lincoln Mercury. And so his crazy fraternity brothers wanted to use that car for their road trip. Now, he knew he shouldn't have given the keys. Everybody watching the movie knew he shouldn't give them the keys, that it was going to be a bad outcome. We all knew it. And yet, he gave the keys to his brother's car, and of course, they took the car and trashed the car. And at some point afterwards, they said, Flounder, you messed up, or something to that effect. You trusted us. We all know if we give the keys, the nuclear keys to Iran, that we're going to look back and say, we really messed this up. We trusted them. And so I echo what's already been said here today. I don't know what reason we would have to trust. And we all know if we give the nuclear keys to these folks that we're going to regret it. Thank you for coming today.
Thank you so much, Mr. Clausen. Ms. Frankel.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I may be a little repetitive, but there are three points that I'm interested in. First of all, thank you all for being here. Number one is, how confident are you that we would be able to verify a complete Iranian compliance with an interim agreement? And number two, what lessons should we learn from our history with North Korea? And finally, do you have an opinion as to whether a comprehensive agreement should require Iran to come clean on its entire nuclear program, including weaponization? And I waive the rest of my time, Madam Chair.
Those were excellent questions. Thank you so much, Ms. Frankel. And now we will turn to our witnesses. Thank you very much for being here with us. We are pleased to welcome Mr. William Tobey. He's a senior fellow at the Harvard Kennedy School's Belfer Center for Science and International Affairs. Previously, he was deputy administrator for the Defense Nuclear Nonproliferation at the National Nuclear Security Administration and has served in the National Security Council staff. Welcome, Mr. Tobey. Second, we welcome Ms. Rebecca Heinrichs. She is a fellow at the George C. Marshall Institute, where she has concentrated her research in the areas of nuclear deterrence and missile defense. She has also held fellowships from the Heritage Foundation, the Foundation for Defense of Democracies, and has previous work as a congressional staffer. Do we pronounce the S in the last name,
yes,
Heinrichs?
Ma'am. Yes.
Okay, thank you. And last but certainly not least, we welcome back Mr. David Albright, founder and president of the Institute for Science and International Security. He has authored numerous assessments on covert nuclear weapons programs throughout the world, as well as regular publications on scientific research. We welcome all of you. Your prepared remarks will be made a part of the record. And Mr. Toby, you will be recognized first after that great intro from Mr. Issa, Mr. Historian.
Thank you, Chairman Ros-Lehtinen, Ranking Member Deutsch, and members of the committee. It's a pleasure to be here to speak about a matter of surpassing importance. Preventing Iran from obtaining a nuclear weapon is a vital American national security interest. The committee has asked to focus today on Iran's noncompliance with its safeguards obligations, and from the opening statements, it's already clear that the committee has a profound understanding of those issues. So I will confine my remarks to just 3 points. First, in 2005, the International Atomic Energy Agency's Board of Governors found that Iran had violated its safeguards obligations by failing in a number of instances over an extended period of time to make necessary declarations. Second, since 2011, the International Atomic Energy Agency's Secretariat has expressed serious concerns about the possible military dimensions to Iran's nuclear program, which Tehran refuses to clarify despite being required to do so under the Joint Plan of Action Agreement. And I would note that many of the members referred to the so-called possible military dimensions, and I think that gets to the heart of the important issues on the Iran agreement. Third, in August 2014, less than 6 months ago, the United States Department of State sanctioned an Iranian government organization for ongoing nuclear weapons development work. In sum, Iran has violated its safeguards obligations in the past, is charged by the United States government with doing so in the present, and evinces little reason to believe that it will not continue to do so in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Toby. Ms. Heinrichs.
Madam Chairman, Ranking Member Deutsch, members of the committee, thank you for the invitation to participate in this hearing. I have spent the last 10 years in various capacities, from working for the Congress to working as a researcher in think tanks, studying specifically how the U.S. can deter the most catastrophic kinds of attack, with an emphasis in ballistic missile defense, which is critical should deterrence fail. Arms control is just one tool for deterring the spread of strategic weapons. But for it to be effective, as President Obama said in his 2009 Prague speech, rules must be binding, violations must be punished, words must mean something. Administration officials have said that Iran cannot be permitted to achieve a nuclear weapons capability, which if it did would be in violation of the NPT as well as several Security Council resolutions. But to allow Iran to maintain its ability to produce a nuclear weapon while also relieving sanctions would signal to foes that violations, if persistent enough, could end in reward. It is important to keep at the front of our minds the context of which the P5 plus one has attempted to secure a diplomatic solution. Iran views the U.S. and Israel as its principal enemies. And over the past 3 decades, Iran has very intentionally created a network of terrorist surrogates able to target U.S. interests and Israel. The regime does not view the P5 plus one talks as an opportunity to reconcile with the West. To the contrary, Iran has failed to instill confidence in the most optimistic of U.S. diplomats that it is sincere about maintaining a peaceful nuclear program. At the recent APEC conference, Ambassador Rice said the administration holds a distrust and verify policy towards Iran, an important twist on President Reagan's policy towards the former Soviet Union, trust but verify. But Iran to this day stonewalls the IAEA's efforts to verify the Iranians' claim that the nuclear program is exclusively for peaceful purposes, making verification nearly impossible. In 2000, 11 in November, the IAEA laid out possible military dimensions of the program. The agency concluded that Iran had been undergoing a structured program that included possible weaponization activities until the end of 2003, but then went on to cite activities related to the development of a nuclear explosive device that continued after 2003, and noted that these particular activities could remain ongoing. And just last month, the IAEA report confirmed again that Iran still has not provided any explanations that enable the agency to clarify the outstanding practical measures. But even if the agency were permitted unfettered access to Iran's scientists, documents, and facilities, and able to get to the bottom of Iran's weaponization activities, by all accounts, the negotiations do not include Iran's missile program. Iran wants more than a nuclear weapon. Iran wants to be able to credibly threaten its adversaries with a nuclear-armed missile and also with a variety of conventionally armed missiles. The DNI assessed that Iran would likely choose a ballistic missile as its preferred method of delivering a nuclear weapon if one is ever fielded. Missiles are a cost-effective way for a country like Iran to pose an asymmetric threat to much more militarily sophisticated countries like the U.S. Therefore, Iran is motivated to keep and improve its arsenal and has defied UN Resolution 1929 in order to do it. For example, it is improving its accuracy of missiles to threaten ships in the Persian Gulf and the Strait of Hormuz, and is on a determined course to achieve an intercontinental ballistic missile capable to threaten the U.S. homeland. Under Secretary of State Wendy Sherman, seeming to back away from her previous commitments to include Iran's missile program before this committee, said that a comprehensive agreement, although it's important to address the Resolution 1929, a Resolution 1929 is, quote, not about ballistic missiles per se, end quote, but about nuclear-armed missiles. But a ballistic missile can carry conventional or a non-conventional warhead, including those that are chemical, biological, and nuclear. In closing, Iran continues to support terrorism, and there is no evidence that it has made the political decision to move away from achieving a nuclear weapons capability. Getting to the bottom of what the IAEA identified as the possible military dimensions of Iran's nuclear program ought to be a necessary condition to moving forward with any kind of real negotiations. But even if this is accomplished, any deal focused on Iran's nuclear program must include its missile program. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Albright.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, Ranking Member Deutsch, and other members. And thank you for inviting me to testify today. Adequate verification is critical to a long-term nuclear deal with Iran. Robust measures are needed to ensure declared nuclear sites engage in only peaceful activities, and more importantly, to ensure the absence of undeclared nuclear material and facilities in Iran. Although the interim deal under the JPA strengthened the monitoring of declared nuclear facilities, it did little to increase the IAEA's ability to detect and find covert sites and activities. The IAEA has regularly reported in its quarterly safeguards reports on Iran that it is not in a position to provide credible assurance that all nuclear material in Iran is used for peaceful activities. Whether this situation changes will largely depend on the ability of the United States and its partners to create a long-term agreement that establishes legally binding conditions on Iran that go beyond those in the Comprehensive Safeguards Agreement and the Additional Protocol. A critical question will be whether the agreement establishes a verification regime adequate to promptly catch Iranian cheating. There are many reasons why an agreement must require extraordinary verification arrangements, as been pointed out today so far by I guess, every speaker. The most critical ones are Iran's well-documented violations of its safeguards agreement, its actions inconsistent with that agreement in a peaceful nuclear program, and Iran's long history of non-cooperation with the IAEA. Let me just list a few additional examples. Iran has built several nuclear facilities in secret. It's been pointed out that Iran has violated its comprehensive safeguards agreement prior to 2004 on multiple occasions. Iran has depended extensively on illegal overseas procurements of a range of goods for its nuclear programs in violation of national laws and UN Security Council resolutions. At least one illegal procurement for the Iraq reactor complex was attempted after the JPA went into effect. Although this is not a violation of the JPA, it does violate UN Security Council resolutions. Iran has not allowed the IAEA to visit the site at Parchin, which has been mentioned already, or other sites associated with past work on nuclear weapons research and development and other military nuclear activities. Iran has delayed inspectors' access to sites and extensively modified buildings and or the sites themselves in apparent efforts to thwart IAEA verification methods. And of course, Iran has stonewalled the IAEA in resolving the inspectors' concerns about the possible military dimensions of Iran's nuclear programs. This record demonstrates why Iran has a significant confidence deficit with much of the international community. As a result, verification conditions in a long-term deal will need to be rigorous, unprecedented, and long-lasting. These extraordinary conditions need to remain in place for at least 20 years. This time frame should be sufficient for the IAEA to achieve full confidence in the absence of undeclared Iranian nuclear materials and facilities and in the peaceful nature of Iran's nuclear programs. To that end, several measures are needed to ensure adequate verification in a long-term deal. I agree with other members and with my panel that Iran must address the IAEA's concerns about Iran's past and possibly ongoing nuclear weapons research and development. An agreement that sidesteps the military nuclear issues would risk being unverifiable. Moreover, the world would not be so concerned if Iran had never conducted weaponization activities aimed at building a nuclear weapon. If no concrete progress on this issue is forthcoming by July 1st, a deal should not be signed. If Iran in good faith asks to delay demonstrating concrete progress until after a deal is signed, it should not receive any sanctions relief until it fulfills this commitment, along with providing a roadmap on resolving the rest of the IAEA's concerns. Visits to Parchin and related sites and access to key individuals should be part of Iran's demonstration of concrete progress. United Nations Security Council sanctions on proliferation-sensitive goods, such as dual-use high-tech goods, should be maintained during the duration of the deal. Authorized nuclear programs could be exempted from these sanctions via specially monitored procurement channel. Often overlooked, these sanctions are critical to building an adequate verification regime. These sanctions are a fundamental part of ensuring that Iran is not secretly establishing the wherewithal to build secret nuclear sites, make secret advances in its advanced centrifuge or other nuclear programs, or surge in capability if it left the agreement. And finally, a deal must include legally binding provisions that allow the IAEA to conduct snap inspections or anywhere, anytime inspections. These provisions need to also require broader Iranian declarations about nuclear activities than those required in the additional protocol. These conditions should last for at least 20 years. So thank you very much for the opportunity to testify.
Thank you very much. Excellent panelist. And I'd like to ask unanimous consent that our subcommittee recognize our special guest who's with us, Mr. Trent Franks, for a statement he'd like to make.
Thank you kindly, Madam Chair. I appreciate your holding this hearing so very much. And as it happens, Ms. Heinrichs was the military legislative assistant in our office, and she taught us essentially everything we know about missile defense. And we're just extremely proud of for the direction that she's gone, that she's able to teach other members of Congress. And I think she is a force that is important to the world, and I really appreciate you being able to hear her testimony today. And I don't want to embarrass her. She didn't know I was doing this, but we are very impressed with all the great things she's doing. And with that, I'm grateful for the opportunity, and I yield back.
Well, thank you so much, and I think that that was an accurate assessment of her capabilities, and she made a most excellent presentation. So trained by the best. I don't know which way that training went. I think knowing you, Trent, it went toward you. But thank you so much, and I'm so pleased with the testimony today and with the members present. And this is an extremely important topic. The administration's argument is that this deal will allow us to have the mechanisms in place to monitor and verify Iran's compliance with any final agreement, to hold Iran accountable, and to prevent it from getting a bomb. All wonderful desires, wonderful outcomes. But as most folks pointed out, every indication from past history suggest otherwise, that Iran's continued stonewalling of the IAEA will continue. And even during the implementation of the JPOA, this stalling and this stonewalling was taking place. So it gives us further cause to be less than optimistic. As the ranking member pointed out earlier this week, Oni Hainonen, the former Deputy Director General of the IAEA, who we've had testifying before us, and Ray Take, and former NSA and CIA Director General Michael Hayden, stated in an op-ed in the Washington Post that even if the nuclear deal manages to push Iran's nuclear breakout time to 1 year, that's the stated goal, this might not be sufficient to detect and reverse the Iranian violations. And so I wanted to ask the panelists, what are the difficulties in achieving a verification regime that would be capable of detecting, of testing, of acting to stop Iran from possible breakout for both the IAEA and their standards and the U.S. intelligence community? What difficulties do we have in getting such a structure in place? We'll begin with Mr. Toby.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The difficulties are considerable, and they're made worse by what at least has been reported about the shape of the deal. You referenced a one-year, creating a one-year breakout time. That, of course, deals only with declared sites. So that would ensure, or would aim to ensure, that the declared sites were not used to make nuclear weapons. But the problem is that I think most analysts believe that were Iran to move in the direction of nuclear weapons, they would use undeclared sites, covert sites. And the burdens that are placed on any verification program for detecting covert sites are made much more difficult by the allowance of some enrichment work. Now, I know that that's been bitterly disputed as to whether or not Iran should or should not be allowed to have any enrichment capability. But I think it's indisputable that if they have some capability, it will be more difficult to verify that that capability isn't being diverted to covert sites. So that is why it is so centrally important to get to the bottom of the so-called possible military dimensions that all of you have referenced, all of us have referenced. All of us in this room understand the importance of that issue. And I think it has to be gotten to the bottom of in order to ensure that future activity. It's not about the past, it's about the future.
Absolutely. Ms. Heinrich.
I agree with what my colleague just said. I also just would like to point out that because their nuclear program is so inextricably tied to their missile program, the missile component is something that's not hasn't been gotten discussed as enough as what it should be, but missile detection is much easier to do than to detect the weaponization elements of a nuclear program. So, and we can already see what they're doing with their missile program. So, Mr. Toby is correct. It's almost impossible to get to the bottom of the verification if they don't even disclose what they've done in the past, and we need to do that first. But I would suggest that an easier way to actually see what they're doing is just look to see their massive missile program.
Very good point. Mr. Albright? If you can push that little button. The
administration's goal of having a one-year breakout criteria makes sense. I mean, you need something to drive the negotiations. Now, as Mr. Toby pointed out, I mean, it's easier to apply to declared facilities. And where the difficulty is, of course, is if Iran is going to try to do it covertly. And I would say it may do a hybrid of an overt or using declared or an undeclared facility. So, I mean, there's many paths to the bomb. But I think the verification, if done rigorously, can actually lead to a situation where you could do this in a year. But it certainly would, from my point of view, would need to include coming clean on PMD. You'd have to be able to make sure Iran isn't smuggling goods in for a covert site. So you would need the UN Security Council sanctions to remain in place for the duration of the deal. You're going to have to empower or give more tools to the inspectors. They're going to have to be able to go, in a sense, in a very quick way on notice to sites where there's suspicions. They're going to have access. And so you're going to have to wire all this in an agreement. And if it isn't wired in an agreement, then I think that it'll be very hard to satisfy the one-year criteria for undeclared sites.
True. Now, as we know, Iran impedes any and all IAA inspections that it can that may be related in any way to its suspect activities, including the PMD. And we were talking about the SNAP inspections, the anytime, anywhere inspections. Many people believe that we need that in order for this deal to be credible. How likely is it that the Iran deal will include these inspection parameters, that they will have this SNAP anytime, anywhere inspections? Will we insist on it? Will the IAA insist on it? The intelligence community, will they be satisfied with what is in the deal to detect Iran's noncompliance if these SNAP inspections were not guaranteed in any final agreement?
With respect to the anytime, anywhere inspections, I don't know whether or not those will be a part of the agreement, but I would point out that there are other elements that may be as or more important. It's an important deterrent to have the ability for inspectors to go any place, anytime. But it's not how you generally detect a covert operation or a covert nuclear capability. That's done by talking to people, by examining records, by much broader declarations, as Mr. Albright already referenced, by the sort of patient and careful work that would lead inspectors to understand that covert activity is underway. And it's only at the last moment that one would actually take the final step to go and visit a site.
Have to do the homework before to be able to have that SNAP inspection.
Absolutely. So that some teeth. All of that work is at least as important as the ability to go anytime, anywhere.
Thank you, Noah. I believe the only real way to prevent Iran's breakout is to dismantle its nuclear infrastructure. As long as we're only getting access to what Iran wants us to see, there's no way to know, as you've pointed out, the real extent of Iran's nuclear program. And the current JPOA is limited to only declared sites, as you pointed out. It's the undeclared sites that should really worry us. Mr. Toby, you stated that by doing this, though, it actually facilitates Iran's ability to cheat. If you could explain that.
I'm sorry, by doing?
The current JPOA is limited to only declared nuclear facilities, and by doing this, we're actually perpetuating that.
Exactly. The focus of the talks has been creating this one-year breakout time. So we've gone from a situation where the president's originally stated goal was preventing Iran from getting a nuclear weapon. In other words, changing their strategic calculus. Now our goal is putting a one-year speed bump between Iran and a nuclear weapon. Unfortunately, that applies only to declared sites. And the only way to get at undeclared sites is a twofold operation, which Mr. Albright has already referenced. One is to get to the bottom of these so-called possible military dimensions, and the second is to be able to understand and monitor all of the equipment and materials that Iran is either importing or creating itself that would be applicable to making nuclear weapons. So without those two elements, any agreement would not be verifiable.
And Mr. Albright, getting back to the SNAP inspections that you were talking about, how can the IAEA monitor and verify any Iranian activity at sites that are actually undeclared? If you could push that button.
Question about the would this be an agreement? I mean, I think there is worry that it won't be. I mean, there's certainly indications that the administration is making compromises. And the Iranians have been very tough on this. I mean, this was told to me by one of the negotiators well over a year ago that the Revolutionary Guard had sent a signal through the Iranian negotiators that there was no way the IAEA would be allowed to visit military or Revolutionary Guard sites. And so that was stated as one of the essentially two major red lines. And of course, that's unacceptable, but will the U.S. push hard enough to overcome this red line and get to ability to have anywhere, anytime inspections? Now, of course, we'll see, but I do worry about it, and I think that without those, I would expect they wouldn't get the broader declarations too. that there is a real risk that you won't have the package of measures needed to do adequate verification.
Be interesting to see. And one last question, and I thank the members for allowing me all this time, and you'll have that time as well. Ms. Heinrichs, you've done extensive work on Iran's ballistic missile program, and as you pointed out in your testimony, written and verbal, several UN Security Council resolutions explicitly seek to curb Iran's missile program, but how closely related are Iran's progress on its ballistic missile program and its nuclear program? And do you think that the negotiations will include or should have included other aspects of Iran's dangerous activities, including its support for terror, its ballistic missile program? We had a full committee hearing last week, and I think Mr. Blinken, we asked him, is Iran the foremost state sponsor of terrorism? And he said, well, it's among the top. I can't even imagine what, except for North Korea, who's in that league. But anyway, if you could tell us about the ballistic missile program and other aspects of Iran's dangerous behavior.
Thank you for the question. I think it's possibly one of the most important questions. Iran's nuclear program is inextricably tied to its ballistic missile program. They go hand in glove. So if we simply pause their enrichment capability, for instance, they've already mastered the ability to enrich, so they could, and they're very patient, so they can go ahead and take a pause on that and then continue the more difficult aspects of their program, which is their delivery systems, their ballistic missile systems. So ballistic missiles, they're relatively cheap if you're going to try to pose an asymmetric threat to a country that's much more militarily sophisticated than Iran, like the United States. And that is exactly what the Iranians have been working on doing. They have just successfully orbited their fourth satellite, which is, that technology is directly transferable to an ICBM capability, and the intelligence community still assesses that Iran will be able to test an ICBM capability, which would give them the ability to coerce the United States homeland by this year.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Mr. Deutsch is recognized.
Thanks, Madam Chairman. Mr. Albright, the negotiations, during these negotiations, we've been told that the goal, ultimately, is to cut off the four pathways to a nuclear bomb for Iran. Fordo, Natanz, Iraq, and covert program. Are those the only four?
That covers it. I think that there's always more, but that's the main pathways that the administration needs to worry about.
And the access, the unprecedented access that we're told we've received during this JPOA, during the interim deal, does not include anytime inspections?
No.
What do we have now?
Well, there's better monitoring at declared sites, and there's some more openness at parts of the centrifuge manufacturing complex. But in general, no, there's the measures that were put forth as part of the JPA were never intended to be able to increase the IAEA's ability to detect covert sites.
So what is it going forward? You said we need anywhere, anytime inspections, and that those need to be in place for at least 20 years. Is that, just given the reports in the news, would that be 10 years beyond the deal, or would that be... would that require a deal that's 20 years long?
It could be done independently of the limits on the nuclear program. I mean, if there were, one would assume the limits on the Iraq reactor are indefinite. They won't be reversible. So once they're put in place, there'll just be limits on the ability to make weapon-grade plutonium. On the centrifuge number, those could be lifted after some period of time. These inspection arrangements, these broader verification requirements, must continue past that, I would argue. I mean, you're going to need them for a long time. In a sense, Iran has been in noncompliance for 20 years. I mean, it has a severe lack of credibility, and 10 years is just not enough.
Right. What does that mean? They've been in noncompliance. Take a step back. We're all steeped in this. We've been focused on this for a long time. For people who are tuning in to these talks, because it's the very end, and there's a lot of talk they understand about striking a deal with Iran and stopping them from acquiring nuclear weapons, why are we concerned? What have they done wrong all this period? And weaponization and the creation of a bomb. But they tell us that they want to have a peaceful nuclear program. What for people who haven't paid attention, explain to them why this matters so much.
Well, it's a little bit like someone who breaks the law. I mean, Iran has been deceiving the IAEA, the international community, for 20 years or so. And its intention was to put together in secret nuclear capabilities, and part of that capability appears to have been oriented to getting nuclear weapons. And so in a sense, you have a situation where they've been caught and convicted. That's in a sense what the UN Security Council resolutions signify, and that they're on probation, and that we need time in order to verify that they are reformed. And in that period, you need to limit their ability, in a sense, their freedoms to move on nuclear programs.
And they've not verified anything to date. A lot of us believe shouldn't consider making a deal if they're not willing to come clean on the past military dimensions of the program. Would it make sense for us to do that?
Well, I think there, obviously, the administration is thinking about not doing that. I mean, I think that's pretty clear, or doing it in a much more limited way than maybe we've discussed today. Now, I think one of the problems of doing that is if I can go back to the days of the agreed framework. I mean, people were really scared of war with North Korea in 94, and a decision was made to call off the inspectors. And a deal was made that it essentially hobbled the inspectors. They were brought forth to do monitoring. And I at the time was supportive of the agreed framework, but I understood its weakness. In this case, there's a risk that if you don't get the IA strengthened, it doesn't go into this deal knowing what Iran has done in the past, you are hobbling them and undermining their ability to verify. But in this case, unlike the North Korean case, the IA is going to be called upon to be the lead investigator, in a sense, to determine whether Iran is complying.
Right, so that's what I want to understand. So the IAEA, Iran has completely stonewalled. They've not been forthcoming. They've not granted the access to the IAEA. They've not answered the questions posed by the IAEA, which stem from the fact that we know that, as you point out, we know that what Iran was trying to do, develop nuclear weapons, they were caught, they were convicted, but we're now at the point where they're not complying with what the world has expected them to comply with, right?
That's right.
So the question is, going into a deal, if there is one, regardless of what the deal looks like, if it's the IAEA that is ultimately the entity that is going to monitor and verify whether the terms of a deal are being lived up to by the Iranians, how can that happen? How do we trust that can work, given 20 years of experience that we've had with Iran's interaction with the IAEA?
Well, I would agree that it can't work. I mean, no one's looking for Iran to have a mea culpa. I mean, it would be nice and it would be very helpful. But there are ways to do this short of that. But Iran can't continue to, it essentially almost abuse the IA. They issue reports. One came out a couple weeks ago, which is just belittles the IA. And also, in that report, they argue strongly that the IA's verification, as it exists today, should be weakened. So you have a situation that is unacceptable, and Iran does need to face up and make changes in how it views verification and how it treats the IA and how it satisfies the IA's condition. And I would say that it may be that in the way the administration is negotiating this is that you can't force Iran to do this before the deal is signed, but you certainly can say no sanctions relief until they at least make concrete progress on addressing the IA's concerns.
Right. So the question is, if there is a deal that's reached, the moment that a deal is struck, if there is sanctions relief of any kind, and according to the reports in the press, which is what we have to go by on the current negotiations, according to the reports in the press, Iran's sticking point is that they want massive sanctions relief or total sanctions relief at the outset. If you provide any sort of significant sanctions relief the day the agreement is signed, you will have rewarded Iran for 20 years of bad behavior, flouting international norms, and ignoring the demands of the IAEA. Isn't that right?
Yes, I agree.
And finally, if the goal is a year's breakout time, and we've just gone through all of these concerns about the IAEA, is a year enough time? Is that goal enough for the IAEA to detect a potential breakout, to verify it, and then take action to stop it, particularly given that there are other countries, Iran may argue, the other countries, the P5 plus one, the UN may be brought in. Is a year breakout time realistic if the IAEA is the entity that's tasked with enforcing it?
Yeah, at declared sites, I think it is. I mean, and again, I think some of this depends on the U.S. being willing to take military action if it believes there has been a violation and it's confirmed. And the idea with the year is that there would be enough time to gather international support to avoid that. But in the end, some of this is going to rest on the U.S. being willing to do that. Now, on the covert sites, if the verification is not improved from what would be traditional IA safeguards and additional protocol, then it's going to be tough. I mean, you could easily have a situation with Iran where you do spend a year arguing in the United States, internationally, on what's happened. Is it really a violation? You may have trouble pulling together a coalition, and the U.S. may be put in a position of having to decide, does it take military action when there's deep opposition to that military option? So I think it... But if the verification arrangements are done properly, then I think a year can be enough. But it is going to require a very intrusive verification system, and it's unclear if that can be accomplished.
And anything, Madam Chairman, I appreciate the indulgence. Anything short of that, then, anything short of unprecedented anywhere, anytime inspections demanded by the world of Iran, which Iran should comply with, given their history and given what else would be included in this deal. Anything short of that makes that one-year breakout time, which has been the goal, we've been told, of these entire negotiations, significantly, perhaps dramatically less than 1 year, leaving us with a dramatically reduced period of time in which to respond.
It could be, but they're not. But one thing I would say, anywhere, anytime is not unprecedented. That language is adopted from what South Africa said it would do after it decided to come clean on about its past nuclear weapons program, which also was a big fight. South Africa refused to do that initially, despite the evidence, but under pressure decided to come clean and accepted this idea of anywhere, anytime inspection. So I think it's not unprecedented. But I do think that there's a lot of parts to verification, and so I wouldn't want to say that if you don't get one exactly as you need it, that the thing falls apart, that you have to look at it system-wide. But without any time anywhere inspections, the job gets much harder.
Right. I appreciate it, Madam Chairman. Thank you. And I thank the other witnesses for your testimony and exchange. I didn't want to exclude you, but I'm out of time. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deutsch. Mr. DeSantis of Florida.
Mr. Toby, are you comfortable with the enrichment ability that's contemplated under this deal? It had always been that they weren't not going to be able to enrich. Now they have a substantial number of centrifuges. Are you comfortable with that?
The original idea to ban all enrichment was to keep Iran from gaining the technical capacity to understand that, so they couldn't mount a covert effort. Unfortunately, that horse is out of the barn. So the original rationale for that, I think, is diminished. At the same time, zero is a lot easier to verify than some higher number, which would allow the technology and equipment perhaps to be diverted. So while I think it's not an ideal situation, the only terms under which I would be comfortable is if we had two additional verification provisions. One would be to get to the bottom of the possible military dimensions, as we've talked about, and the second would be to have firm control over the materials and equipment that Iran either produces or imports, as Mr. Albright has described. So this would be an ongoing monitoring situation. And so by allowing some level of enrichment, I think it demands a much more rigorous verification system.
The 10-year sunset that's reported, is that adequate?
It doesn't strike me as adequate. This issue was reported by the IAEA Board of Governors to the UN Security Council 10 years ago. I'm dumbfounded that we might have an agreement that would be shorter than the time it's taken to negotiate it.
Ms. Heinrichs, do you agree with that? 10 years to just simply walk away after 10 years and trust that they're going to behave? Does that bother you?
No, I don't think that we should trust them now. I think 10 years is not adequate because what we really want is for them to make the political decision to move away from a nuclear weapons capability, and they have not done that.
In terms of the military sites, because it seems to me that if you're not having any type of inspection of those sites, if there are secret sites and we have no reason to take Iran at its word, seems to me that they could abide by the deal in the sense of allowing full inspections, and yet they could still end up developing a nuclear weapon, correct?
One thing I would point out is that Secretary Kerry, I think reasonably, said it's unacceptable for Iran to be 2 months away to have a 2-month breakout. If it's unacceptable today, I don't understand why it becomes any more acceptable 10 or 15 years from now. And at least what's been reported was that the broad restrictions on the Iranian program would fall away after 10 or 15 years, which would enable them to move right back to that 2-month breakout period.
What about the military? I mean, even if the inspections were allowed to go to these sites, if the military sites are not included, then they could conceivably keep the deal with respect to those inspections, but still develop a capacity. Is that inaccurate?
It's a fear. I mean, that if the IAEA can't do its job and get to the bottom of what's happened, the PMD issues, namely, and then be able to continue verifying no activity at those sites and among those people and potentially other sites, then it would be an agreement where Iran could just wait it out. But the idea is that you try to at least have restrictions on the program for a generation. That was the goal. I mean, looking back a year, the goal was to have restrictions, pretty strict restrictions on the whole program for a year, intrusive verification, and that over that period of time, you would then develop confidence that they wouldn't try to get weapons in the future. So,
or give more time to have a change in the regime or a change in the nature
right.
of the
so,
regime.
And so the more you, if you shorten, so it's just 10 years, then of course you have to worry more. Now, I would say be careful. We don't know the details. I mean, the administration is going out of its way to confuse us, I'll admit, when they talk about using double digits or they use terms like at least 10 years, they talk about phasing on the enrichment program. So I think the situation is very confused. But I do think it's very logical to demand that the verification conditions either be permanent or last at least a generation. And I think that has to be a very clear message that the administration hears.
Yeah, look, I'm mindful about the kind of jumping on some of these reports. At the same time, you do look at the behavior of the Gulf states and what they see. Their behavior is not very comforting in terms of this being a deal that they have confidence in, and obviously they fear an Iranian bomb very much. Look, my bottom line is, you know, we've seen different examples of this where North Korea obviously didn't work. I think Gaddafi, he feared he was going to be removed from power. He really was worried about the threat of military force. And I just wonder whether Iran really believes that that credible threat is on the table. And if they don't, then man, I think that they have every incentive to want to cheat this deal. I am over my time and I will yield back. I'm good. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. DeSantis. And thank you, Mr. Boyle from Pennsylvania. Thank you, sir.
As you might remember from my brief opening remarks, consistent with, I think, pretty much everyone who has spoken on both sides of the aisle here, I come to this whole issue as someone who's highly skeptical that we could reach an agreement that reasonable people would have full confidence in. That said, it is worth remembering, I think it was Ms. Heinrichs who quoted President Reagan, trust but verify, He quoted the Russian proverb, dovii no provii. The reason why we remember that is because it was said at a signing ceremony with Mikhail Gorbachev. And so those agreements that after the failure at Reykjavik, when the agreements were signed in 87 and 88, they were criticized at the time by some as naive and going too far. And I'd say that history proved President Reagan pretty well in terms of reaching those agreements. So toward that end, while I am highly skeptical given Iran's repeated history of bad faith behavior with the IAEA and with the international community, and being with one of the largest, if not the largest, exporters of terror in the world, all of that having been said, if by some grace of God, a new leadership were to come in Tehran, actual real Western-oriented moderates who wanted Iran to rejoin the international world and give up this path that they've been on over the last 3.5 decades, what would a real agreement look like that each of you would say, that is something that is worth signing, that is something that we could place trust in, and actually have real confidence that it was actually an agreement worth signing?
In terms of a technical model, it's already been referenced, the South Africa example is probably a good one. I would also look for markers of a strategic decision, just as you described, that Iran had decided to forego pursuing nuclear weapons in favor of a better relationship with other nations. And frankly, I do come back again to this possible military dimensions issue. If they're not willing to come clean on that, it not only makes verification more difficult, but it's a marker of Iranian intent, because they clearly want to hide something in order to preserve it. And so I would say that an agreement that looked like it was going to be useful, and that's what I think all of us here seek. I mean, the reason we have criticisms about what may be taking place, it's because we want a better deal, not because we don't want a deal. It would be to get to the bottom of that issue.
I appreciate the question. I mean, I would agree that we have to get to the bottom of the possible military dimensions, but again, I think it's a bit of a litmus test if you to look at their missile program. There's no reason that the Iranians need to be as dedicated to their massive ballistic missile arsenal as they have if they don't intend to use it for coercion. And who are they trying to coerce? It's the United States. It's the United States' influence in the region. And so I think unless we see a political decision or a strategic decision of the Iranians to move away from this ballistic missile capability, which I believe is inextricably tied to their nuclear program, and then allow complete unfettered access of the IAEA to its nuclear program to show that they are actually coming clean, essentially, the South Africa example being a good one, then we should not trust them enough to secure a diplomatic solution to this problem.
Yeah, I think one of the worries is that it was alluded to earlier that they'll just wait it out. And they did some of that during the time of the suspension from 03 to 06, and President Rouhani bragged about how they were able to advance while waiting it out. And so I think one of the concerns now is that the pattern of the Iranians appears to be to basically say that, yeah, we'll give up the IR-1s, which are pretty decrepit machines, but we want to be able to advance our centrifuges and build advanced ones and keep that program alive. And I think that this deal is going to be much less worthwhile if Iran succeeds in being able to do centrifuge R&D on a substantial basis. And I think there's a real worry that that could happen. And clearly, it's where I think the Iranians are building their narrative. And the U.S. has invested a lot into capping and reducing the IR-1 program, which may be the thing that Rouhani cares least about at this point in time. Certainly the nuclear people probably don't care about it. Some other things that are very important is, and I think the administration's made progress, is in getting rid of the stocks of low-enriched uranium in Iran. They can't stay there. Whether they're in hexafluoride form or oxide, they should leave the country. And so I think they've made good progress on getting that established, but whether Iran will go along or not is still an open question. But that, but if there are very minimal stocks in Iran, then that would be, that would build confidence in this deal. The another thing is that that Fordow would be shut down and not involved in any enrichment, that Iran should not be having deeply buried sites that contain any gas centrifusion enrichment capability, that that's critical too. Again, I'm not sure the administration is going to get that or is even seeking that at this point in time. So I think there's many ways that you could put together an agreement, and I think the you, the administration has thought through all of them, and so now the question will be, are they going to come up with an agreement with enough of those in there that one can have confidence in it?
Well, I thank you, all three of you, and see that I've kind of hit my time limit, but I was just asking in closing, and maybe a quick response. South Africa has been referenced a number of times. I think, though not on the nuclear part, but in terms of a country that was clearly engaging in terrorism and then actually decided they wanted to rejoin the international world and that was more important to them under the end of Muammar Gaddafi, that's actually an example of a country that remarkably changed its behavior. I was wondering if we know of any others that we could point to as a potential model to hope and work toward Iran joining.
Well, there's been other victories. I mean, less well known, but Taiwan had a nuclear weapons program, and the U.S. intervened politically to end it, and it was done very quietly. So I think there's other victories. Same in South Korea. It was a little tougher there.
Yeah.
But so I think there's ways to do this. But it, again, I think it depends on the U.S. exerting its influence and the country changing its attitude towards some of these issues. These Mr. Toby raised this issue
In every one of the examples cited, it was ultimately initiated by a decision made in that capital to completely change in which direction it was going and change its priorities, and then behavior behavior changes followed that.
But under a lot of pressure. Those cases involved tremendous amounts of pressure, even South Africa. I mean, there were cases, I was told, meetings with nuclear officials in South Africa with U.S. officials where South African official was fist-pounding, essentially, on the table, denying they had a nuclear weapons program just a week or two before de Klerk admitted, yes, we did have one. So I think the pressure matters. And in South Africa, congressional pressure mattered. If you look back in history, you'll see that the U.S. Congress played a very important role.
I would just add that it was under enormous political pressure, but it was also in the case of Libya, and then as the intelligence community has said that they believe that some of the weaponization activities did cease around the 2003 timeline, about the time that Libya then voluntarily gave up their WMD program, that it was under the fear of a credible threat of military invasion. It was when the United States went into Iraq. So I think that is important to keep in mind, that without the credible threat of force, that some of these things might not have happened.
Well, thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much. And unfortunately, that credible show of force is lacking in Iran. The negotiations look to be, we're playing a very weak hand, and I don't think that pressure is being applied to Iran. And Congress has been muted, and the sanctions are being lifted, and we're in pretty bad shape. But you were wonderful panelists, so we thank you very much for being here with us. And with that, the subcommittee is adjourned. Thank you.